Is the GTX 1050 Ti in a notebook a good solution for gaming? Well, let's find out. Hi, this is Stephen from Owner Disown, and today we're going to be looking at the Dell Inspiron 15 7000 Gaming. It is a budget gaming laptop that fits in between the 1050 models and the 1060 model, and it's supposed to be on par to roughly the outgoing 970M. But it's a Pascal card with various improvements, including VR, so we'll be checking that out. It's not VR certified, but as you'll see later, it actually copes very well with VR games. Now, this model I have retails for about $850. It comes with 8 gigabytes of DDR4 2400 megahertz RAM, and it comes with the i5-7300 HQ CPU. Now, that is a quad-core CPU, 2.5 to 3.5 gigahertz with its turbo clock, but there's no hyper-threading on that. To get hyper-threading, you have to step up a little bit more and go get the i7-7700HQ. And I think that might be a worthwhile proposition. You need to pay around about $930 or so for that. And I think that might be worthwhile. You can also go a little bit high up as well and get 16 gigabytes of RAM for about $1,100. And then for about $1,200, you can get the 4K panel. Now, this comes with a 1080p Full HD panel. And it is probably one of its weakest points, I must admit. It has poor viewing angles. You can see here, it's a TN panel made by BOE. And that's 100% brightness. And outside, too, it's worse outside with its direct sunlight. So if you're sitting at a desk near a window and it's glaring on it, not ideal. If you're sitting in a car trying to type up reports, not ideal. But, you know, in a regular room environment, it's fine. And it must admit, the viewing angles are better than the Sager NP5855 I looked at. Although, the brightness is very similar as well as the colour calibration on it. It's not the best. I wouldn't recommend it for photo or video editing. I think you'd be far better off for using perhaps a 4K panel for that. But for gaming, which is this, I think this one is geared for, it's certainly fine. Now, hard drive options. This comes with a 256 gigabyte SSD. It is a M.2-2280 format SSD. It is a SATA though. The drive that's in here is a SATA drive, but it is a PCI Express slot. So you can upgrade to yourself and get a little bit faster speeds. But that being said, the boot up time is around about 21 seconds. It's certainly fine. And if you look at the reads and writes, around about 510 megabytes per second write and 550 megabytes per second read, it's certainly ample. And there is a spare 2.5-inch hard drive slot there. So you can certainly get those cheap enough and put it in yourself. And it's easy enough to get in. There is one single screw here at the top. You just loosen and they can take the back off quite easily. The screen itself is quite rigid, but there's only a single hinge here. So consequently, there's a bit of twist due to that single hinge. Now, whether that's a weak point, time will tell, I suppose. But I do prefer having a two-hinge setup. But still, there's not that much. There's a little bit of wobble. That's not too bad. Now, the keyboard itself is fairly solid. There's not that much flex. There's a little bit. It's not too bad. You do have some red backlighting on here, which is variable in two stages. So you've got off, on, fairly low, and then a bit brighter still. But it's only one color. But I think the red accents very well against the black. And you do have a number pad here, which is nice on a 15-inch machine. You do have that number pad. And you do have options here to lower the brightness on the screen and also on the keyboard. Now, the trackpad uses Windows precision drivers, so it's fairly accurate. Two-finger scrolling and pinch and zoom work fine. There is a slight roughness to it, but it does move very nicely, and the mouse buttons are integrated and not separate, which I don't prefer. I prefer having separate buttons, but they still work fine. They're accurate, and you don't have to put too much pressure on to make it work, so that's okay too. Now, this is available in a red color too, which I was tempted to get, but I actually do like this black color now. You know, it's grown on me. I do like it, and there's like a soft rubbery touch feel to the lid. Now, it is all plastic construction, but it is solid. It's fairly thin as well, at about 25 millimeters or an inch thick, and you know, it's only about 15 inches long, 10¾ inches wide. So, and it's only about 5.7 pounds, so it's portable, and I think the look of it means that it certainly is able to fit into a business environment very well indeed. So ideal for someone who's traveling and wants a game on the go. I do like the red heat sinks that are here at the back, and also the red grill here at the front. So aesthetically, it's a nice looking machine. And the fact that you can get in easily and upgrade some of the components, it's fine. The Wi-Fi worked exceptionally well. It's an Intel card, dual band, so I did like that. It does have Optima support, so you do get good battery life. Now, it's a 74 watt hour battery in this. You can get up to, say, 7 hours, 45 minutes of battery time. That's a 25% brightness, Wi-Fi streaming, battery saver and power saver on. And I think that's exceptional. I couldn't fault that at all. I also really love the speakers on this. They're really loud. I mean, you do have some software on here, which does improve it too. But I think just listening to the speakers themselves, around about 80 decibels, nice and clear. You do have a subwoofer here at the bottom, so you get up to about 80 decibels. Now activate the Wave Master Pro software, and that goes up to around about 85 decibels, and it's still very clear. In fact, that's pretty much on par to my GT73 VR. So the sound with the software, and the audio without the software. So I think that's exceptional. The software also allows you to configure for using headphones, and also various recording software in there to change the reverb, the pitch. So there's quite a bit of it's quite powerful software there. You've got an equalizer as well to change how the sound works. So I'm very impressed with the sound on this baby. Now, looking at the ports on the right hand side, we have a microphone headphone combo jack. We have two USB 3.0 ports, one of them having power share, so you can use it to charge your cell phone. We have an HDMI and a gigabit Ethernet port. And on the left-hand side, we have a Noble Lock, the power connector, another USB 3 port, and a SD card reader. So you've got some good ports going on there, but there's no Thunderbolt 3 port. So there's upgrade options in terms of putting an external graphics dock on there. Is out the window. That's not going to happen. You have to go to the Alienware line for that. So you have to, this is what you get, and that's it. But at the end of the day, it's $800. So what do you expect? Going on from the battery life, it's pretty power efficient. At idle, it's about 40 watts, and under full load, it's around about 111 watts. So I think that is very good. And consequently, the fan noise is pretty quiet too. I did like that. So the ambient noise is 17 decibels. And at idle, we're about 23 decibels. Fire up a game and we're at 44 decibels. The temperature of the chassis is pretty good as well. Looking at the AWSD keys being around about 25 degrees Celsius. The center here around about 33. The number pad about 28. And the trackpad is around about 21 degrees Celsius. Now underneath does get a little bit warmer, of course. You're looking at about 33 degrees towards the rear and around about 20 to 24 across the rest underneath. Now cooling is by two intake vents here, just directly over the fans. and then of course it blows out here. It does have two RAM slots in here. Of course, one of them is occupied with my 1 stick of 8 gigabytes, so it's single channel. There is a spare slot there to put another one in, so you can double that up, or you can put a 16 gigabyte stick in if should you wish. So it's nice. It's very easy upgrade to do that indeed. Now, looking at again at some of the software, we talked about the Wave Pro software, which is fantastic, I think, for the sound. But it also has Dell Support Assist, which lets you do checkup for your system performance to see if you can improve that at all. Go download drivers or get support, that type of thing. There is some bloatware on here, and we're looking at Candy Crush, Minecraft, Netflix, Paradise Bay, Sling, Twitter, and McAfee antivirus. So if you so wish, get rid of those babies and put your own stuff on. So let's take a look at the 720p webcam.
This is what the webcam looks and sounds like.
So this is a gaming machine after all, so let's take a look at the gaming performance. I was able to overclock this using MSI Afterburner. The graphics card, an extra 212 megahertz on the core and 285 megahertz on the memory. So on Rise of the Tomb Raider, max settings 1080p, we got 44 FPS. Now to try and get the 60 FPS mark, we typically have to go down to medium settings, but high settings yielded 53 FPS, but overclocking it did get it up to the 60 FPS. So it's a 13% increase in performance and able to use high settings. So that was pretty sweet. Now the GTX 1060 at max settings would give 63 FPS, and the 1050 37. So you know, if you're trying to save some money, I wouldn't go down to the 1050 level. Stick with at least the 1050 Ti. The temperature of the CPU and the GPU was still pretty cool. We're talking 75 degrees on the CPU and 69 degrees on the GPU, and in fact they were the highest temperatures I did see on here. So the cooling does do a very good job. Let's take a look at Rainbow Six Siege. So on Rainbow Six Siege, again, max settings 1080p, we yielded 33 FPS. Now this is max settings. You can go down to ultra, sounds strange, but that then gives you 74 FPS, which is fantastic, really good. Now the GTX 1060 on max settings would give 47, and the 1050 would give 24 FPS. So again, I think the 1050 Ti performs great in Rainbow Six Siege. Let's take a look at Mafia 3. Now, Mafia 3 is a very CPU-intensive game. It's one of these big world games where, you know, there's a lot of things going on there. And this is where the i5-7300 HQ, you know, started to buckle a little bit. At 720p, which certainly makes it more CPU, you know, centric, I was getting a lot of game stutter there. You know, it'd stop, pause, keep going. At medium settings, it got 38 FPS. So at high settings, got 34 FPS. So not much difference there. So it just shows that the CPU is holding it back. Now, the in comparison, the GTX 1060 got 41 compared to the 34. And I just threw in there the GTX 1080 because that's the only one I had as a comparison, but you get about double the performance there on the GTX 1080, of course. And again, the temperature was good, 72 degrees on the CPU, 64 on the GPU. So as you can see, CPU and memory utilization is very high in this game. Hence, I recommend the i7-700HQ. So let's take a look at Doom. So max settings, OpenGL 1920x1080p, we get 59 FPS. So we're getting to that 60 FPS mark, which I think is which is great. And this is, of course, max settings. In comparison, the GTX 1060 was about 78, and the 1070 as a comparison was about 118. So shows there's a big difference there. But yeah, you know, for the price, I think that's excellent performance. Temperatures were about 67 degrees on the CPU and 63 degrees on the GPU. Now, since this is available on a 4K panel, I also tested it at 4K, hooking it up to my TV, and at 4K, max settings, 26 FPS. So if you are getting that 4K panel, you're not going to really be able to play any games at native resolution. You'll have to step it down a bit. So let's take a look at Battlefield 1. So Battlefield 1 max settings 1920x1080. The 1050 Ti gives 45 FPS. The 1060, 55, and the lowly 1050, only 29. So again, reinforces not to bother with the 1050 really. High settings yielded 52 FPS. So trying to get to that 60 mark. So high settings is pretty close there. Again, the CPU is cool, 75, GPU 69. Now, Grand Theft Auto 5 is another CPU intensive game. It loves a fast CPU. And also uses quite a lot of video memory too. As you can see here, the GTX 1050, only 2 GB of memory on that, and that would just crash at the max settings. So if you have that card, you scale it back. Now the 1050 Ti, it's 4 GB of memory on it, was able to play quite well. It got 69 frames per second. Can't fault that. The GTX 1070 in comparison was around about 50% more at 93. Now looking at some synthetic benchmarks. Time Spy DX12 benchmark got 2,368 points, and that fell, just as we all expected, right in between the 1050 and the 1060. Now looking at its scores, the graphic score was 2,332 and the CPU 2,600. Again, the CPU was 70 degrees, GPU 63 degrees, so again, nice and cool. Let's take a look at some CPU benchmarks. And first up is Cinebench R15. So looking at the multi-threaded test, we get 474 points with a temperature of about 64 degrees. In comparison, the i7-6700HQ is 681 and the i7-7700HQ 738. So that shows how much, you know, improvement you do get having that hyper-threading. Now, the single core score was 129. Also, interestingly, when you run Cinebench and Heaven benchmark at the same time, of course, you do get lesser performance. In fact, this dropped way down to 134 points, which took quite a bit of a hit. The CPU still stayed fairly cool though at 73. Using the laptop to encode a video from using Handbrake, which loves fast CPUs and is multi-threaded, to convert a 4 GB file into MP4. We get a score of 57 minutes. It's longer than the i7-6700HQ, which was 45 minutes, and the i7-7700HQ, which was also about 45 minutes. So it gets the job done, not the fastest. Again, I think if you just spend that little bit extra, $80 or so, and got the i7-7700HQ, it would make all the difference. And I would certainly recommend doing that. So this is not VR certified. You have to go for the 1060 for that. But can you save quite a bit of money? For example, a 1060 probably retails for around about $1,200. So you could save probably a good $300 or $400 getting one of these. And can you still play VR games fine? So I put it to the test. First up is Serious Sam VR. And as you can see, it played it well. No problem at all. Setup was also a breeze. Often I find with like the 980M and so forth, you have to go through various hoops with the virtual compositor, but here it's plug and play. Worked just as well as a 1060. I also tested it on raw data, which is probably one of the most intensive games and hardest ones to play. My 980M, for instance, could not play that. Could not play it at all. But this played it flawlessly. And this is supposed to be on par to a 970M. So I'm thinking if you're wanting to get into VR, this is a good cheap option to do so. I think it'll probably play every game out there. Personally, if it plays raw data, it can certainly play most of the games, I would say. So conclusion, what do I think of this GTX 1050 Ti laptop? Well, just looking at graphical performance alone, I would say that it's 47% faster than the 1050. So you may save $100, but I wouldn't even go there. I think sticking with the 1050 Ti would be much better. Now, comparing it to the GTX 1060, that was certainly faster, about 22% faster than this, but it costs 40% more. So there's a big differential there. Plus, you can overclock this by 13%, so that then only gives a 9% differential. Granted, you say this can't be upgraded. The GPU is soldered on the motherboard, but most of these other ones are too, the 1060. And unless you can get a 1060 with a Thunderbolt 3 port, you're not going to be able to attach an external graphics stock, which you can't do on here. So the upgrade path is a little bit lower, is lower on here for sure. The CPU does slow this down a little bit, but in general gaming it's fine. But in those big open world type games, you may start to struggle. Mafia 3 saw that. It was okay in Grand Theft Auto 5 because you did have the 4 gigabytes of memory, but I would still go for the i7-7700HQ for the extra $80. That will help you in any of the CPU tests you want to do, any video rendering, that type of thing. The display is the weakest point on this for sure. I wish it did have an IPS panel, but it gets the job done. It's okay. You know, I mean, the viewing angles aren't great, so it's not a good multimedia machine, but it's perfectly fine for office work and gaming. You know, if you want to do more serious photo editing and that type of thing, you may want to look for the 4K panel, which would cost you about $1,200. I think the build quality is fine, and I think aesthetically it's very nice. It fits well into a business environment. Particularly the black one, you can get a red one too, which I still think is fine. That's perfectly good. Cooling on this is fantastic as well. Let's say the CPU did not throttle at all, and fan noise is unobtrusive. So again, if you're working in an office, that's not going to disturb people. Now, the speakers, I thought were one of the best here. I mean, really are. So for me, I love the long battery life of about nearly 8 hours, and the brilliant speakers of about 85 decibels. So, you know, if you want to use it to listen to music, it's fabulous. It really is. Competition wise, you do have the Acer Aspire VX15. That's available for about $1,000 with 16 gigabytes of RAM and the i7-700HQ CPU. So that is a good contender there, and I hope at some point I can get my hands on one and test that. But I think certainly, for value, the 1050 Ti notebooks are certainly very good. So anyway, thank you for watching. Thumbs up if you like, and sub if you'd like to see some more. Bye now.